Members of the head table, and I understand we have the chairman of the Police Service Commission here here with us. We have members of various ministries, including our own line ministry. It is my honor and privilege this afternoon, as the director of the Cipriani College of Labor and Cooperative Studies, to welcome you to the first lecture of the college's Center for Intellectual Debate series for 2015-16. As we enter our 50th year of existence, we join the trade union movement worldwide to recognize the World Day for Decent Work 2015. We are pleased and delighted that you joined us this afternoon. I know you have several different options for what to do with 5 o'clock on this afternoon, and we are pleased that you decided to come here. This day has also been declared a day of action to stop precarious work by the International Trade Union Federation. As a College of Labor charged with the mandate to build the capacity and consciousness of the labor and cooperative sectors of Trinidad and Tobago and the region, we join the international labor movement in its call for decent work for all workers. We do hold sacred our call as the institution where industrial and employment relations professionals and practitioners of the nation and region can think about labor law, labor institutions, including the industrial court, labor practice, including negotiations and conciliation, where we train these professionals within the context of labor constitutions of the region and the world. And no, I am not a labor lawyer. I am an industrial engineer. But like you, we all have responded to this seminar, to the invitation to this seminar, where Senior Counsel Douglas Mendes will deliver the keynote lecture centered around the landmark judgment awarded by the Privy Council against Acelor Mittal in a matter around the issue of contract labor. There are a couple of themes at this college we hold dear: responsibility, courage, knowledge. Responsibility and courage to join in the struggle against contract labor and other forms of what becomes all too often precarious work. But we do that from a position of knowledge. This is very important because work impacts not just livelihoods of workers, and as a result, living standards of their families, but work and the ability to contribute speaks to the heart of our nation's quest for sustainable development. As part of the lecture discussion this afternoon, the college invited our chairman, Mr. Lennox Marcel, to respond to the lecture. We have also invited Dr. Ralph Henry, economist and international consultant, and chairman of the Heritage and Stabilization Fund, to make brief remarks as well to the lecture. Both responses will be from the point of the socioeconomic implications of this Privy Council judgment on the labor sector. That means on workers, on employers, and on the government as the largest employer of all in the country. Then we will open up the session to questions and answers from the audience. I expect our discussion this afternoon to become very involved and very exciting, for want of a better word. This College of Labor and Cooperative Studies is exactly the kind of forum where these kinds of discussions can find voice. In too many cases today, colleges and universities have not engaged the great ideas or the great problems of our times in ways in which we of academia are intimately involved and capable of handling as responsible members of our society. We join with you today at Cipriani, the premier tertiary level academic institution in the region, in our areas of labor and cooperative studies. We do not plan to fail in this mandate to society to do what a very good friend of mine calls, let ideas contend. We do not all agree with positions, and this judgment that answered one question has created several new questions. Precarious work. Work. Contract labor. Job security. What exactly is work? What is decent work? Contract work. Is contract work work equivalent to precarious work in all forms and at all times? Given the widespread use of contract labor and other forms of what can very quickly become precarious work, the trade union movement has identified the emergence of a new class of worker, the precariat, workers who do not have sustainable jobs. We are in an environment, however, around the world, where 75% of all labor is contract labor. The world has changed. What do we at the college, with the knowledge that we have, and the responsibility and the courage to move the agenda, have to do with it? Work reflects priorities on the social, economic, and political agenda of our country and region and the international system. We live in a globalized economy. We forge an international consensus among governments, employers, and workers to produce and develop work. At the college, we take that mandate in terms of cooperative businesses, the most successful form of business. This evening, you are here with us. We are delighted that you're here. We're looking at globalized economies, contract labor, and workers' protections. And I put that in the plural. We're part of this struggle for rights, the right to work, the right to produce work, rights at work. So those are three very different rights. The college is delighted that you're here to struggle through the issues. Welcome. And I'm looking forward to a wonderful evening of discussion. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Denise Margaret Thompson. So as you would have heard, the theme this afternoon is the globalized economy, contract labor, and workers' protection, the Acelor Mittal Case Unveiled. And let me say how really pleased we are in terms of the response, because when we would have been planning that this is the joint trade union movement, we were wondering, okay, what will the response be, because we're talking about contract labor, and everyone knows how the trade union movement feels about contract labor. As a matter of fact, our part of our campaign is to stop precarious work, to end contract labor. We felt, well, let us see what the response would be, and we put an ad, and we had this tremendous response. So I guess a lot of people would like to hear what is the impact of this case, this historic case, Steelworkers Union versus the ArcelorMittal company. In so doing, I want to recognize those who would have responded and would be here with us this afternoon. So please join me as I recognize the audience here. First of all, let me recognize the faculty and the students of the Cipriani College of Labor and Co-operative. I'd like to recognize members of the credit union movement who are here with us this afternoon. And I see, of course, faces many of us are familiar with from the Ministry of Labor. Let us give the representative from the Ministry of Labor who's here with us. And then from the, we understand based on registration, we have quite a number of people from the public. We have persons from various companies, from even from regional corporations, just interested citizens who came here. I would like to recognize all of those who would have come here this afternoon and joined us. Let us recognize them. recognize the trade unions that are here with us this afternoon. I would like to start off by recognizing the Amalgamated Workers Union who is with us here this afternoon. I would like to recognize a good-sized contingent from Postal Workers Trade Union. I see you. I'd like to recognize comrades from the Contractor and General Workers Trade Union. I would like to recognize comrades from the Estate Police Association and comrades from the Fire Service Association and even from the Prison Officers Association, who I'm here speaking out loud today. So we cover the protective services. I'd like to recognize comrades from the Industrial, General and Sanitation Workers Union, who's with us here this afternoon. I would like to recognize comrades from the Banking, Insurance, and General Workers Union. I would like to recognize our comrades from Communication Workers Union. I would like for us to recognize, and I saw some comrades from Seamen and Waterfront Trade Union. And I would like to say welcome and recognize comrades from the Public Service Association. I would like to recognize comrades from the Transport, Industrial, and Workers Union. I would like to recognize comrades from the Blue Shirt Army, the Oil Field Workers Trade Union. And I really left this union for last because I really want us to show recognition. You see, the Steelworkers Union is what you call a small union. It's not a big union, small union, but with big courage, huge courage. Because this union took on an international or multinational corporation. Acelor Mittal is not a small or medium or even large local firm. It's a multinational firm. And it took on that giant. So therefore, I really want us to recognize the entire General Counsel of the Steelworkers Union.
I wasn't expecting them.
And therefore, it's a pleasure for me because I think it is important that we cannot start this session without hearing from this union, this courageous, heroic union. So I bring on to bring some remarks the president of the Steelworkers Union, that is none other, and a very strong supporter of the joint trade union movement, Comrade Christopher Henning.
Comrade Douglas Mendes, a friend and a comrade, other members of the head people, members of various unions, members of the public, good afternoon. After 19 years of struggle, I stand this afternoon a very satisfied president of the Steelworkers Union of Trinidad and Tobago. The term justice may be slow, but is sure, is more than adequate to capture the sequential events of this case. I am satisfied that these workers, after working most of their adult life for this company, my friends, my brothers, my sisters, my comrades, will finally be compensated. I also stand very sad here this afternoon because these comrades who would have worked in various bargaining unit positions at various times of their lives were denied for 19 plus years basic terms and conditions, which are medical, vacation, sick leave with pay, housing plan, and most importantly, a pension plan, to mention a few, which in turn denied them a good standard of living because they were forced to be precarious workers. What is even worse is that some of these workers have passed on, have died, and did not see one red cent coming out of this Privy Council judgment. Hopefully, the surviving beneficiaries will. I want to just take a minute and ask if there are any comrades who have been awaiting justice from this matter to stand and be recognized. Are there any comrades? Discussion this afternoon is not isolated to any specific class of workers, because all workers at all levels are affected. It is a cancer that all unions around the world is fighting against. Our union recently received calls from the Caribbean, South America, and as far as Africa, congratulating us on our steadfastness in having pursued the injustice against the workers to the Privy Council and being victorious. I must openly thank the learned senior counsel, the friend of steelworkers, who fought this battle at the industrial court, through the appeal court, and at the Privy Council, the true champion of the working class. And I want to say, I was a little younger when I gave I was part of the industrial court matter, where I was a witness. And then I saw the learned senior counselor, the appeal court, fighting and battling for these workers. And then I went and traveled to London with him at the Privy Council. And I saw him battling for the workers there too. And then on March, 5 o'clock in the morning, we stood up because of the time difference, and we heard the judgment given in favor of the workers, and that was one of the happiest times of our lives, of my life. There must be a continued effort by labor to ensure that all workers have an opportunity to decent work and a decent standard of living. I must mention, comrades, that after 19 years of struggle at the Ministry of Labor, Industrial Court, Appeal Court, and being victorious at the Privy Council, the company, Acelor Mittal, as we speak, continues in their illegal activities by having contractor workers working in bargaining unit jobs. And this capitalist multinational is adamant to continue with a neoliberal agenda to oppress workers and take them back to slavery. And we as a union is expected to follow the rule of law. The right to go to the ministry after they do want to have bilateral talks, refuse to come to the ministry, some of them. Then we have to go to the industrial court, and because of the deep pockets, we go to the appeal court and the Privy Council. And that is how they tend to address matters in this 2015, this year, this year, going forward. And while we would gather here as labor, as to discuss and public, other NGOs and other company representatives, I see some of them here too. Companies would have already sat to try to see how they could combat this judgment coming. They would have already got together and started to talk about how they could combat this, to be able to continue in their ill ways. Ladies and gentlemen, be informed that the union health is not under the sun. We will continue to embrace any opportunity to engage social dialogue because there is a need to have a tripartite approach where we can address the challenges that is common to parties and those that are unique, such as low production, low wages, management inefficiencies, to mention a few. I want to end by saying that Steelworkers Union and the Joint Trade Union will continue to fight a good fight and represent workers, the working class, at the highest level. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Comrade Christopher Henry, President of Steelworkers Union, for that very passionate and emotional presentation. And I was particularly happy that you asked the comrades who would have been impacted directly to stand, because sometimes we forget that we're dealing with human beings, with people who have families, children, brothers and sisters. And I think it was very important for us to remember the human faces even as we analyze this case. I would like for us to really give the comrades and them another round of applause. Now, of course, we know that comrades and brothers and sisters would have been coming here to hear about this case. So what we wanted to do, because we wanted to ensure that it's really a, not just an educational activity, but a consciousness-raising one, we wanted to provide some material so that when you registered, you would have gotten a folder. Unfortunately, because we had a target, when we sat at JTUM and we analyzed our mobilization, we actually had a target of some 200. Well, we were off. For the first time, just, you know, the other way around, right? So what we will ask, especially in terms of the unions, to ensure that you copy some lead within the unions so that the other members and officers can get a copy. Because the folder has not only the Privy Council judgment, but we also felt it important that you read the Industrial Court judgment as well. So in your package, you would have received both the Industrial Court judgment as well as the Privy Council judgment, and we've also put in a two sheets of papers, one on precarious work, what it is, and the idea of this new precarious class that is being created as a result of precarious work, but also the question of contract labor and contextualizing in terms of globalization. And this is why we came up with the theme, globalized economy, so that we can understand the connection between contract labor, precarious work, and the neoliberal agenda, so that you have that in your package. So that brings me straight to the celebrity which has helped this huge response. As Comrade Henry would have said, he saw Comrade Mendes, and yes, I can freely call him that, Comrade Mendes, battle for those workers at the Industrial Court, Court of Appeal, all the way up to the Privy Council. But Comrade Mendes, as many of you all know, have battled for many of us, many unions inside here. And I really want to say that he's truly, let me take this opportunity in this forum to say that he's truly a friend and comrade of the working class of Trinidad. His work, his commitment, and his effort have helped pave the way for persons to have an improved quality of life, and his commitment to the trade union movement. Because, you know, throughout time, people have different things to say, but one thing we're sure about is that the trade union movement has contributed significantly to the development of Trinidad and Tobago. And we have also benefited from the commitment and dedication of comrades such as Comrade Douglas Mendes. So let us show our appreciation and bring on Comrade Douglas Mendes, Senior Counsel, to deliver the keynote lecture.
Members of the head table, students of the Labour College, comrades, members of the public, friends, thank you very much.
for those very embarrassing words. I thank you, of course, for inviting me to make this address, let me call it a feature or keynote address. Yeah, I'm kind of frightened if it will live up to that description. But anyway, the decent work agenda developed by the organizers of the World Day for Decent Work on its website defines decent work as work which is meaningful and productive, pays a living wage, provides benefits and social protection, and is protected by strong labor laws that guarantee workers' rights, including the right to join and be represented by a union. Among the International Labor Organization's strategies for securing and promoting decent work is a campaign to get all countries to adopt a set of minimum international labor standards, and in that regard to ratify a core set of ILO standards. The premise is that decent work cannot be fostered unless workers' rights are protected by law. Without such protection, respect for workers' rights is poor at best, and employers are often free to abuse workers with impunity. The Industrial Relations Act is the centerpiece of a collection of labor laws in Trinidad and Tobago, designed to offer protection for workers' rights and to provide a place where workers, through their trade unions, can go to enforce those rights. The Act is far from perfect. To mention just one imperfection, the procedure for obtaining recognition is far too cumbersome, time-consuming, arbitrary, and fraught with uncertainty. But that is a topic for another day. Once certified as a recognized majority union, the representative trade union acquires exclusive rights to bargain on behalf of members of the bargaining unit, to conclude collective agreements on their behalf, to represent them in all manner of trade disputes that might arise at the workplace, and to take proceedings before the industrial court to enforce those rights. A registered collective agreement binds the employer and the trade union and becomes the terms and conditions of the individual contracts of all workers comprising the bargaining unit from time to time. Most importantly, the agreement is enforceable in the industrial court and in the industrial court only. These are things that all you all know, just sort of rehearsing it, setting the stage as it were. Obtaining union representation is no small thing. The records where they are kept show that the benefits which workers enjoy under collective agreements are usually significantly better than that enjoyed by their non-trade union counterparts. Having a trade union stand as a buffer between the might of the recalcitrant employer and the lonely isolation of the individual worker makes a difference on a daily basis in the lives of workers. But it is precisely because of the effectiveness of trade union representation that employers will fight tooth and nail to avoid the implantation of a trade union in its midst, or to evade the application of any collective agreement by which it might be bound when it has not succeeded in keeping a recognized union at bay. There are a number of mechanisms that employers deploy to achieve this. Among them is the proliferation of insecure employment, by which I mean employment in which there is inbuilt insecurity of tenure. Fixed-term contracts, temporary and part-time employment, and things like that. Contracting out work normally performed in the bargaining unit is another such mechanism trade unions have had to contend with over time. When a fixed-term contract comes to an end, the employer has the option not to continue the employment. This may be for a good reason or a bad reason. Whichever it is, there is no protection against an unfair dismissal, because in fact there is no dismissal at all. the contract simply comes to an end. Where work is contracted out, the employer has no responsibility for the workers who may be performing formal bargaining unit worker. That is the responsibility of the contractor. So that the collective agreement does not imply, and there is no transfer trade union representation, unless the contractor is held to be a successor employer. Then there is what we might call the contracting in of labor, or what is referred to in the Industrial Relations Act as labor-only contracts. I call it contracting in because the workers involved actually turn up for work at the employer's premises, as opposed to the typical contracted out work, which might be performed elsewhere. Typically, the services of workers under labor-only contracts are provided to the principal employer or the end user by a contractor acting really as an employment agency who is responsible for paying the workers' wages. This is a mechanism used to avoid collective bargaining relationships or the applicability of collective agreements because it enables the employer to contend that even though it uses the services of the workers concerned, it has no contract with those workers and accordingly, they could not be his employees. Sorry. The relationship has been described as follows, I quote, "The contractor's service is tantamount to a mere agency recruiting service for which a commission is paid. Beyond this, there's little or no employer-employee relationship between the contractor and his recruits, for the latter not only work side by side with the principal's regular employees, but they are also under the direct supervision of the principal company, which exercises the same degree of control over them as it does over employees in its direct employment. Timesheets of the so-called contractor's employees are generally maintained by the principal company, which determines and computes the amount of wages payable through the contractor. And not infrequently, the principal determines by names the persons to be recruited for particular jobs, thereby directing the contractor who is and who is not to be hired. The principal also exercises the right to terminate the services of such employees. In short, it is the principal company which hires and fires the so-called contractor's employees. What the prevailing practice amounts to in the final analysis is that persons so employed have no true contract of employment with the contractor, who is fictitiously represented as the employer. At the same time, the true employer, that is to say the principal, is able to escape by way of the labor supply contract, the usual responsibilities of an employer, and without having to pass them on to the contractor." Close quotation. Sorry for that long quotation. But that is a direct quotation from a report of a commission of inquiry into the consequences for workers resulting from undesirable features of the system of contracting out work, which was chaired by Dr. Zin Henry. That report was submitted on October the 24th, 1972. The commissioners describe the practice as, quote, "the most striking of the exploitative systems of employment which was encountered by us in our investigation. It was said then to be prevalent in the petrochemical and cement industries. 43 years later, I am here talking about a recently decided case dealing with the same phenomenon, but this time in the steel industry. In 1972, representatives of principal or end user companies who appeared before the Commission of Inquiry sought to justify the use of labor-only contracts on the ground that it is difficult to obtain direct employment with services of skilled workers at short notice for casual employment, as one of the reasons they gave. Another reason is that the contractor is better able to provide greater continuity of employment to such workers by shifting them from job to job and that the contractor better knows the competence and dependability of the men he supplies, which in turn removes much of the uncertainty in the direct employment of persons for skilled jobs. Those are all the rationalizations given at the time. They also justify the practice by putting forward the claim that the workers involved benefit from the industrial agreements covering regular workers by way of minimum rates of pay, hours of work, and overtime rates stipulated in these agreements. Tell the steam workers that and see if they agree. But the commissioners were unimpressed. The evidence before them showed that the vast majority of employees who worked under labor-only contracts were unskilled. It showed that the contractor supplied labor to one principal company only, and that such arrangements were entered into to the total exclusion of any direct employment of casual employees. The commission found it shocking, to say the least, and I'm quoting, to have discovered that a former employee of a company's personnel department resigned from his position with the company for the sole purpose of entering into a labor supply contract with his former employer. And worse than that, the workers supplied by this contractor were recruited from the pool of casual workers which the company previously ran through direct employment. In summary, the commissioners found that the arguments put forward by the protagonists were advanced merely as, quote, convenient rationalizations for practices which the commissioners thought to be sinister in conceptuality, immoral in character, and exploitative in consequences. That's 1972. Indeed, one of the contractors had admitted during examination that these arrangements were callous and inhuman. The commissioners recognized that the labor-only contract phenomenon was not peculiar to Trinidad and Tobago, but was fairly common in many countries where it had been frequently condemned in various quarters, including in learned judgments of courts. But the commissioners were chagrined to note that there were a few unusual features in the system as practiced in Trinidad and Tobago. In the first place, the practice in Trinidad and Tobago exists at the level of the main contractor who enters into the labor supply contract, whereas in other countries, it existed only at the level of subcontracting. Secondly, the principal company, instead of the contractor, exercised supervisory control over the workers involved and also had the de facto authority in hiring and firing. And lastly, the system used, not infrequently, as a total alternative to direct employment, casual and temporary workers across the board. It is no wonder that the Zinn Henry Commission of Inquiry called the practice exploitative. Labor laws protecting workers apply only where the worker concerned fits the definition of worker under the relevant legislation. If you are not a worker as defined, you're not covered. That usually means that you have to show that you are employed under a contract of employment. And in order to prove that, you must establish what is called mutuality of obligations. And for a contract of employment, that means that there must be an obligation to pay in exchange for an obligation to take instructions. Control by the employer is a defining feature of the employment relationship, along with the concomitant obligation to pay for the work the worker is ordered to perform. With the triangular relationship established in a labor-only contract, however, the normal rules for determining the existence of an employment relationship break down. The contractor who hires a worker pays his or her salary, but does not direct the work that he is to perform. There's accordingly no employment relationship between the worker and the contractor. But because the principal employer or end user does not pay the worker's salary, there's no employment relationship there either. Even though the end user principal employer directs what work the worker does. Left to the strict application of common law contractual principles, therefore, a worker employed under a labor-only contract would fall into a sort of legal black hole. She is neither fish nor fowl. She's paid a salary and does work, but she's not anyone's employee and therefore not entitled to the protection of labor laws. An entire industry of employment agencies developed around these concepts in the United Kingdom. It is estimated that upwards of 60,000 people are employed under these arrangements, the fervent belief being that corporate lawyers had found in these triangular relationships a fail-safe method of avoiding troublesome statutory obligations, such as unfair dismissal remedies. The argument developed was that if the obligation to remunerate the worker is imposed on one person, whilst control of the worker is vested in another, there cannot be a contract of employment with either. What prevented there being any contract at all was that the two critical elements of any contract of service, the obligation to remunerate and the right to control, were located in different parties. But there has been serious pushback by more liberal judges in the United Kingdom who have found it possible in theory to find an implied contract of employment between the worker and the end user, principal employer. One judge said that the notion that a worker was employed by no one was simply not credible and defied common sense, and that there was just simply something wrong with it. The Zinn-Henry Commission has appreciated all the legal and moral flaws in the labor-only contract system, but did not think it necessary to make any ameliorative recommendation because of the presence in the Industrial Relations Act of a section which read as follows. This is the labor-only contract provision. Where a person engages the services of a worker for the purpose of providing those services to another, then such other person shall be deemed to be the employer of the worker under a labor-only contract. So that was a provision that was designed to make sure that a worker employed under a labor-only contract was employed by someone, and once we find that employer, then the obligations under the Industrial Relations Act will arise. And this, of course, then brings us to the litigation between the Steelworkers Union and Acelor Mittal Point Lisas Limited. The evidence in that case had established a widespread practice of the long-condemned labor-only contracting. There were two companies which Mittal had engaged, both owned by the same person, SMS and MTS. They provided Mittal with a steady stream of workers. There were those who employed with Mittal on a full-time basis and worked continuously on the company's shift system. There were those who worked intermittently. There were cleaners and helpers who worked on a regular basis, and there were those who worked on a casual basis, substituting for Mittal's regular workers who may have been absent from work due to illness, vacation, training, or discipline. The workers who were employed under this arrangement had been working with Mittal continuously for years on end. Just looking at the list there, some of them 6 years, some of them 10 years and more. They did the same work as bargaining unit workers, and they took their instructions from Mittal supervisors. They turned up for work at the same time as regular Mittal workers and were subject to the same health and safety dangers. But they were not paid the same as regular Mittal workers, and they did not get the same benefits such as vacation and casual leave. In short, the collective agreement was not applied to them, even though they were performing bargaining unit work and worked alongside workers who were covered by the collective agreement. The reason given by Mittal for this extraordinary state of affairs was that those workers were not its employees, were not members of the bargaining unit, and therefore the collective agreement did not apply. In other words, Mittal was taking the same position which the Zinn-Henry Commissioners of Inquiry had condemned decades ago. The case took a long time to be tried, during the course of which at least three collective agreements had come and gone. In his judgment delivered on 31st July 2009, His Honor Mr. Patrick Rabatali had no trouble finding that the workers were employed under the labor-only contracts, as the union had contended. He therefore ordered Mittal to apply the appropriate collective agreements to them. Mittal appealed to the Court of Appeal, where they got no jury, and then to the Privy Council with the same result. To be clear, Mittal did not appeal the industrial court's finding that the workers were all employed under labor-only contracts, and therefore that Mittal was in fact the employer. They didn't appeal that finding. What they appealed is the order that the appropriate collective agreements apply to the workers. To be clear again, Mittal did not contend that collective agreements do not apply to labor-only contract workers. What they contended was that there was an agreement between counsel appearing on behalf of the union and the company that the claim for the applicability of the collective agreement to the workers had been abandoned. Well, they couldn't find any indication of that in the record anyway, but they claimed it nevertheless. That the industrial court did not give it an opportunity to be heard on the question whether the collective agreement should be applied to them, and that the court could not order expired collective agreements to be enforced. All of these must be familiar to you. You've gone over this ground so often. All of these arguments were rejected by the Court of Appeal and the Privy Council. And to a great extent, therefore, there's little contribution to the law as it applies to when a labor-only contract can be said to come into existence in any of the judgments of the Court of Appeal or the Privy Council, because that simply was not an issue anymore. But the judges in the Privy Council did say some very important things, and I'm going to quote. They said, a registered collective agreement only applies to workers who are employed by the employer who is a party to the agreement. It appears to the board, and does not appear to be in dispute, that a registered collective agreement applies to and its terms and conditions are deemed to be the terms and conditions of the contracts of employment of workers comprised from time to time in the bargaining unit who are deemed by Section 24B to be employed by the employer under labor-only contracts. In other words, it is now confirmed at the highest level that collective agreements apply to workers employed under labor-only contracts. The contract workers who are among workers comprised in the bargaining unit, this is what they continue to say, to which the provisions of the registered collective agreement applies. It follows that the terms and conditions of the registered collective agreements were deemed to be the terms and conditions of each of their individual contracts of employment. They were therefore entitled to be paid at the same rates under the collective agreements as those workers whom the appellant recognized as employees, and to be afforded the same allowances and other benefits provided for in those agreements. And then they noted that the only reason really why Mittal was not providing them with these benefits was because they did not consider them to be its employees. So having settled that issue, it followed naturally that the collective agreement had to be applied to them. Fortified by these pronouncements at the highest level, it is now left to the trade union movement to educate its members that collective agreements are to be applied equally to all workers in the bargaining unit, including those sent there by employment agencies, in other words, including those who are contracted in. I have seen examples of unions accepting and legitimizing labor-only contracts by going so far as to obtain recognized majority union status with the contractors themselves and negotiating collective agreements with them. Maybe that is one effective way of dealing with the problem. At least it achieves the protection which the Industrial Relations Act offers. But if this scourge on decent work is to be eradicated altogether, it might be better to take a unified stand and insist in each case that the collective agreement with the end user principal employer be applied across the board. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Comrade Douglas Mendes, for indeed unveiling the implications of this case. And I believe everyone here can agree with me by saying, indeed, this case will have a profound impact on the labor landscape of Trinidad and Tobago. They can all run, but they can't hide anymore. We have allowed for two short presentations of what we call discussants to enrich the discussion. And then to be sure, because I'm sure everyone in here have a lot of burning questions that they would like to ask senior, And we are going to provide that space for you. So, but in the meantime, I would like to first call no stranger to many of us. He's been also close to the trade union movement for a very long time, and that is none other than Dr. Ralph Henry, who will give a sort of socioeconomic impact of this issue of precarious work. So please join me in welcoming a longtime friend of the people.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, Madam Principal Director of the College, Mr. Mendes, Senior Counsel, and a long-standing campaigner. I've had the privilege of working closely with him many moons ago. I don't know if he remembers this, when I was involved with the Public Services Association. Other members of the head table. My presentation is going to go entirely in a different direction because I think this historic judgment has to be seen in a larger context. I want to compliment the Steelworkers Association, the union, and its president for this battle that they have waged over many moons, so many years to achieve justice for the workers. But in so doing, you have to see your battle in context. We in this country have waged a war and have won a war of enshrining a certain system of industrial relations. I know in the 1960s, when that battle was being waged, many of us were totally opposed to the establishment of the industrial court and all the paraphernalia that went into the recognition, the certification board, etc., etc., and thought that the battle should be waged on the streets. I think we have come a long way and we've recognized the value of the court. And although I am no lawyer, or at best a bush lawyer, and sometimes I presume to wear satin, you know, I tried to read the deposition of our members of the industrial court and the judge who delivered his position, and one could see that he was doing this against a historic backdrop, and that is what was commented on by the learned judges and the Privy Council. And we don't have to go into it. But I want us to see where we are. The principal made mention of globalization, the forces of globalization. And I want to be very brief, but to recognize that we are in a world that has changed since the establishment of the World Trade Organization, and the commitment of countries, including our own, to this free and open market competition across the world. But in that regard, what we have done really is to enshrine the privilege of capital to move wherever it wants in a way that labor is not allowed to move. And that is an issue that we have to confront. Because the company that we are talking about, one is first by establishing itself, having moved from India, I think it went to Indonesia first, and ended up as Ispat Caribbean. And then I don't have all the details of the history, but it also acquired assets in Mexico. and moved on. And the last bit of important steps that it took, saw it being supported by the British government when the Berlin Wall came down in acquiring assets in the so-called iron curtain countries. And from then on, we saw it move to acquiring the French company. So it's now a major conglomerate, concentration of capital. And in that concentration, it has been able to develop options. So it's even more mobile. And we have to take that into account. Because one of the responses might be to move elsewhere. And if they're moving elsewhere, we're not sure what will come after. And we have to be prepared as a country, as part of our industrial policy, to run companies in the national interest. It's a long stretch, but it may happen. It may happen. But we have to also take account of the fact that in this plethora of institutions, because this is basically what it is, that we have been able to create an institutional structure that allows for some degree of balance or rebalancing in the conflict between labor and capital, and has corrected for some of the power that capital has over labor. So that wages and other conditions of service are all captured in that. It's all this conflict over the control over labor. And the institution of the industrial court and all the other paraphernalia have allowed us to some level of balance. But you can see how they can take us the distance. And take us the distance today. And, you know, our steel workers have, you know, that strength of steel in their resolve. But don't think that the fight has ended. And we have to see this case, because it's happening, you know, I think our share in recognizing all the unions that were here mentioned the postal union. And that one is dear to me. Because in the 1980s, when I started negotiating for public sector unions, I knew we had a problem with our postal workers. Because look at what has happened with technology. Less information travels in hard copy. There are less letters in hard copy. There is far more mail that is moving, and the postal workers are in no way involved. So technology, this technical change, and all these things taking place, and we have to see, you know, how what we do, how we ensure we protect workers, all workers, in this relationship between capital versus labor. Let me, because I know there are lots of questions, but there are lots of issues that we have to face. But I just want to focus on two or three of them. As part of the institutional environment, we have the International Labour Organization, which in a sense dates back even before the establishment of the United Nations, and has attempted over the years to come up with conventions and rules and, you know, get countries to observe these rules. So that we are signatory to a number of conventions, you know, the right. I don't think we have enshrined the right to work. Although there are countries that enshrine that right to work, we have not for bargaining units, etc., etc. And you can see that over time, our employers have attempted to get around this through flexibilization of work, creating these, you know, other kinds of arrangements, the contract work, etc., being one part of it. How to get around institutions. But these are institutions, the institution of the industrial court, and, you know, it's in a sense, it takes some of its the principles from the International Labour Organization of all these rights and conventions. You know, our country subscribes to that, on the one hand, but we also subscribe to WTO. And, you know, the free movement of capital. Right? And then we also, as this country, subscribe to another view, which is that as a country, we ought to promote certain kinds of industry. And that is what cohesiveness is all about. That as part of our industrial policy, we decided that we're going to set up certain kinds of industry, we're going to attract certain kinds of industry. And sometimes that results in the government turning a blind eye to some of the arrangements that employers coming from abroad, employers, foreign capital coming into the country and wanting to, you know, the government wanting to attract this foreign capital, will turn a blind eye, we encourage to turn a blind eye to some of the rules that we ourselves put in place to cover our industrial relations. So that we have labor laws that might at times, or industrial policy arrangements that might at times be in conflict with our industrial relations laws and the spirit of our industrial relations laws. Simply because the country wants to attract certain kinds of industry and wants to attract certain kinds of capital. So we have to put that into the mix. And at the end of the day, we have to see all of this not only in the context of, you know, this that we have won a battle, but rather in the context of the kind of country we want to create. Because what is implied in all of this is that the wage, the terms and conditions of service can be determined within a band. And of course, the employers want to be at the lower end of the band. And we as workers want to be at the upper end in terms of this division between labor and capital. So I want to put all that on the table. It's a whole mix, but we must not be, you know, forgetful or oblivious to these realities as we look down the road, as, you know, look down the road in the context of the judgment that we have won. Thank you.
Just to say that he was one of the first lecturers here at this college some, you don't look so, but some 50 years ago. And let me just say, in terms of those two key issues, one, reminding us of the power of capital, we must never ever underestimate the power of national solidarity and international solidarity of workers. We, the joint trade union movement, stand in full solidarity with our brothers and sisters and our comrades from Steelworkers Union. And in regards to the possibility of Acelor Mittal moving, yes, that is always a possibility, but it means that we as a people must be prepared to exercise our right to self-determination and therefore not be afraid to run the steel industry ourselves. The next discussion is again no stranger to many of us, and that is the current chair of the Cipriani College of Labour and Co-operative Studies, that is none other than Mr. Lennox Marcel.
Thank you very much, Chairman, distinguished colleague and senior counsel, Douglas Mendes. First, I would like to congratulate you on your successes, which is not long as 1919, and the first industrial court judgment was 2009. That should give some alarm bells, you know, in terms of the length of time, you know, the length of time taking for the judgment. And here in 2015, we are talking about the outcome. I agree with my friend and colleague, Ralph, that, you know, the institution, the industrial court has grown. And I can understand and appreciate that, because I appreciate the industrial court very much. Because I, you know, at one time I was known as the night stalker at the industrial court, because I entered as a young graduate in 1979 as research officer at the industrial court. And actually I'm very grateful that I have grown in that institution, you know. So, you know, I share that view that the court stood up as it should have in light of this particular issue. And I want to start off by saying to Senior Counsel that he raised a number of issues that we need to address in a wider context. He put on the to us the question of understanding and appreciating the notion of decent work. It is not something that we must just speak about goodly, but about which we must take action. There's a concept that has developed currency in the international labor law and industrial relations environment, where people are now speaking of citizenship at work. So in other words, every individual who works is a citizen of the work process, whether that person is a contract for service worker or a contract of employment worker. And the issue is, if we are citizens of work, there must be equality. So the notion is that there must be equality of terms and conditions at work, regardless of your status being a contract of service or a contract for service. And it also brings us to the question argued by Professor Simon Deacon, Professor at Cambridge University and formerly of the London School of Economics, who argued some years ago that because there's a new work organization, and because of globalization, and there's this challenge between the contract of service status and the contract for status, then the lines are now blurred, and there should be no distinction between a contract of and a contract for. And once you present yourself for work, and you are working in a place of employment, all terms and conditions relevant to that work process must be applicable to all. And I will go further to state that Trinidad and Tobago ratified all the 8 core standards that the senior spoke about, what the ILO refers to as providing the fundamental principles and rights at work. And the ILO, in its declaration of 1998, spoke to those 8 fundamental conventions, which include, you know, freedom of association, the right to collective bargaining, and so on. But the point I want to make in this respect is that the industrial court of Trinidad and Tobago, not now, but over a number of years, the industrial court has taken the position that because of the fundamental principles and rights at work, and Trinidad and Tobago's membership in the ILO, Trinidad and Tobago is bound to all the principles and practices of as enshrined in both conventions and recommendations
by being a member in keeping with the IOC's fundamental principles and rules, and the industrial court has always sought to enforce conventions and recommendations, whether they are ratified or not. Actually, the ILO has always paid tribute to Trinidad and Tobago's industrial board for taking that position. In other words, conventions that are not ratified because of the nature of our legal system, you know, this notion of, you know, the monists and the dualists, you know, our conventions and treaties don't become, you know, binding unless you do certain legal procedures and you do it by parliament and those and so on. So you'll find that if a matter of that nature would go to the High Court or the Court of Appeal in Trinidad and Tobago, they may challenge it and say, well, listen, we didn't ratify it, but the Industrial Court of Trinidad and Tobago was taking the radical position and say, we are recognizing it because we see it as representative of good industrial relations practice. I am also, you know, there are so many issues arising. The first thing struck me is that, you know, Counsel's reference to the question of to ensure that workers are protected, there must be strong labor laws. We adhere to labor standards, international labor standards, as enshrined in the ILO. But we must give effect to that by having strong labor laws. And I refer here not only to the collective labor relations laws at in the IRA, as I was in the IRA, but individual employment rights. Trinidad and Tobago is backward in terms of the rest of the Caribbean and perhaps some areas, other jurisdictions. Yeah. And some other jurisdictions because we have not sought to enact individual rights at work. One of the first things done by Nelson Mandela when he became leader in South Africa was to enshrine and was aided and abetted by the late, recently late, Sir Bob Heppel, who is South African and was a white South African and Mandela's lawyer and a leading luminary in international and labor law. And Heppel pushed him to develop this basic foundation called basic conditions of work. And that is the hallmark of the South African justice system in relation to work. And we need to do that. I can recall in the year 2000, the then administration, of course, most of that work out of the Ministry of Labor then, put on the table a similar piece of legislation called basic conditions of work. The employers protested and it disappeared. It came on the table again sometime in the 2000, this time as employment standards with a different administration, and it went nowhere. I hope during the tenure this time that we will deal with an employment standards legislation which provides for the basic condition and terms and conditions upon which trade unions can even argue for better terms, because these are the basic terms existing in the country. So in other words, this judgment is telling us that in spite of the fact that the ruling says that contracted workers must be treated the same way as workers under collective agreement, we must go a bit further and put in place, as Council recommends, legislation which will give rights to all workers in the economy. So we need individual employment rights. And it drives us to the understanding and appreciation, and many of us have not appreciated that labor rights are human rights. And if labor rights are human rights, then
must be enshrined in law in Trinidad. Some countries have gone on and dealt, you know, we are way back in terms of a number of things. Some countries have gone on and Council referred to the British approach. We also have regulations in terms of how you treat with contract workers, and we need to do that and appreciate that. My time is running out. I want to make about two more points. And that first of all, I think we need to do an analysis of the infrastructure of social protection in Trinidad and Tobago. See where I'm talking here, not only in terms of what applies directly to workers, I'm talking about here social welfare, social security, because all these issues impact on workers at work. So we need to look at what is the social infrastructure supporting workers in Trinidad and Tobago, and where necessary, enhance them. So in other words, we have a lot of work to do in that regard. So we have serious implications for further work in that area. And the last point is a point made by the chair and others, and the question of protecting the, what do you call it, chair? Your comment in respect of protection, what do you call it?
No, that one, but I recall forgetting it on a senior moment.
But you know, the question of, because I'm sure you'll make it, because you make the statement, you made it many times for the night. Oh, I think it's the
precarious.
Thank you. And in terms of that, and I think you said that it's not only in Trinidad and Tobago we have that issue. And recently there was a study coming out of Nigeria where Dr. Rosemary Dancy argues seriously in that regard in terms of what she calls protecting non-standard workers in oil and gas in Nigeria. Faced with the same issue, saying generally, listen, you have laws there, but you must go further. You must go and not only have laws hanging around, but serious laws which will give rise to the complete citizenship of all workers at work, and thus total equality in terms of the protection of all workers, especially vulnerable workers. And the last point is related to the fact that we must, and we have to commend the tribunal movement in this regard, but they must continue the process in terms of ensuring that when the country enters into trade agreements, that or any investment agreement, provisions must be made with related to workers' rights in that regard, in terms of the economy of Trinidad and Tobago at this point in time.
Thank you very much, Mr. Lennox Marcel, Chair of the Cipriani College of Labor and Cooperative Studies, and for highlighting how you've come to understand the judgment and the importance of it. Thank you very much for that presentation. I want to begin the process of opening up the floor to everyone here, but I just want to say one quick thing. Indeed, this court judgment was important for us. And therefore, the role of the industrial court is greatly recognized and appreciated. We also recognize and appreciate the importance and the need, which has just been highlighted, for legislation. Agreed, no doubt. But I just want to remind us, first and foremost, that it was the streets that gave us trade unions. It was the streets that gave us independence. It was the streets that gave us the nationalization of resources. And therefore, it would have to be the streets that protect and enforce the court judgment and to ensure that employers follow the law. In other words, as we appreciate and recognize all those things, we will always, always maintain our butler-like militancy. Because It is that borderline militancy that will preserve the independence of the industrial court. Sorry, I just had to put in my 2 cents there. The floor is now open, and it's now just about 5 to 7, so let me start by put some order. I'm not seeing a mic at the center. You're supposed to be on the roof tonight. Oh, it's coming. Okay, great. So what we will ask is persons who would like to ask a comment, ask a question, because I'm sure there are a lot of questions with regards to this judgment. I want to keep it focused around the implication, the impact of this judgment, both in its wider context as well, yes. So we will ask persons to line up just behind the mic so I have a sense as a chair as to how many people want to speak. And I will allot some 2 minutes to each speaker. Or not even a speaker, let me be clear, because people just go up and clear a speaker. We have already had the keynote address, please. And we've had 2 presentations, all right. And those of you who know me very well know I will be strict on the 2 minutes, all right. I think if you had to be succinct and clear and focused in terms of what you would like to say and or ask, you can do so in 2 minutes. The floor is now officially open.
See about 5. Yes. Hold a second. Just get this room settled up a little bit.
Mine is very short.
Okay. Very good.
Yes. I'll be brief. Good night. My name is Ida Lebrun, the General Secretary of the National Union of Domestic Employees, NUDE. You see, I heard a lot about decent work. And we must ensure that decent work, we can embrace the decent work too. Because we are workers too. Even though that government doesn't recognize us as workers and refuse to ratify the Convention 189, we are workers, because with us, nothing else can happen. So I want to ask the question. I heard Brother Ralph from Arima, that is why I call him Brother Ralph, Arima people. He talked about capital versus labor. And in this environment, I want to know where domestic workers will fall. Who is the capitalist with regards to the work of domestic workers? You know, because when I listen, I'm thinking that is why domestic workers cannot be recognized as workers from 1974 to now. You know, we have been pleading the case. So I want to know if it is, tell me who is the capitalist?
Just one specific question, and I want to address the actual judgment, and it's on page 10 in the original judgment at the industrial court, where it was stated by the union, yeah? And I just want to repeat here. And the contracted workers are paid by SMS at a rate of pay fixed by the agreement between the union and ISPAT. I just wanted to know whether or not, given this generous position by the company, if in fact it was more than just pay, equal pay, but as well as the union wanted, as well as benefits, as included in the collective agreement. So I was a bit troubled by there was an agreement that SMS would pay, the same rate. It was an agreement, actually, between the union and the staff.
Thank you.
All
right.
Good evening. Executive Treasurer and Chief Labor Relations Officer for Steel Workers Union of Trinidad and Tobago. This person is directly for Senior Counsel. Douglas Mendes. But that question has been coming to my office repeatedly. Looking at the union's evidence and arguments, you would have made it quite clear to the industrial court that the list of 18 that is appended in the judgment was not an exhaustive list, and the union was making an application to the industrial court for the company to make available all the contracted workers that would have worked for the company under SMS and MTS. My question to you at this time is, seeing that the 18 or 87 plus workers is appended, in your view, if a worker had in fact worked under SMS and MTS, and is not on that list, and has proved that he or she would have worked within the period, does he or she qualify to benefit under this judgment?
All right, next.
Good afternoon to the head of the table of comments. Oh, I am Jackie Williams of the New Shirt Army. I'm not going to ask a question. I'm going to refer to the macro vision and statements made by Mr. Marcel, Dr. Henry, who are both old enough to let those of us who are that age know, and those who are young enough not to know, that Estat was not always a foreign-owned company. It was established as Escort, and its first vice president in the 80s was a Caribbean man born of Petition parents, and he was a Trinidadian. And that company was not always foreign-owned. National company of this country. So we have no fear to have that we don't have talent and the ability to run that steel company once more as our own company.
I'm not sure I can follow such a fiery comment, but I want to focus on, and by the way, I'm here on seat in attorney at law. I really wanted to focus on the case and the legal aspects of it. One of the things that the company didn't contest in that matter was the issue of whether these workers in fact belonged to the bargaining units. I would like to know, specifically from Senior Counsel Mr. Mendes, what would be the case when there is an issue as to whether the workers fall into a particular bargaining unit, and really which bargaining unit would they fall into? So say, for example, there are two bargaining units, a weekly paid bargaining unit and a monthly paid bargaining unit. And so that the union now pays a third of the workers by reference to fortnights. And in addition to which, the workers don't have regular duties, so they're non-standard. So the other bargaining units have a position for a driver and a position for a janitor. But now they've combined janitorial duties with the duties of a driver. So that are these workers that would they then be left without protection? The other aspect is really something that I wanted to comment on. There is the issue of the labor-only contract as opposed to a regular contract worker who's contracted directly by the company. Who, in your view, would have greater protection? Is it the ordinary contract worker or a worker working under a labor-only contract? My last comment really would be directed to something that Mr. Marcel said earlier, which is the individual rights of the worker. I am just wondering if that would undermine sort of the purpose of the industrial relations system, which is to try to funnel more disputes through the unions as opposed to the individual. Now, I'm wondering if what you mean by individual rights is that rights of individuals can themselves litigate as opposed to going through their union. I'm not sure if that was what was meant, but would that in any way undermine the system of funneling disputes through the union?
Okay, great. Thank you.
Good evening, everyone.
Sorry, can you repeat that?
Elon Mayo, Department of Labor, THA.
Oh,
Tobago enough.
I see my director watching me as well, so I as well. Part-time lecturer at Cipriani College, Tobago campus. this question, where I come from, in within the government realm, you have this thing about contract four and contract two. You have the short-term people, contract short-term, and you have the contract people. And you have a lot of times the short-term people do not have the same benefits as the contract officers. And then they have the contract officers who have 1 year, 2 year, 3 year contracts, not having the same benefits as the civil servants. And there's always a clash. I am hoping that with this landmark judgment, some sort of streamline can happen, because even though within the oil, the industrial sector, you have that fight, you also have that fight within the public sector with contract officers, short-term operators, OJTs, frankly, I'm tired of seeing OJTs, talented young people, basically becoming photocopy experts. Thank you.
All right, I'm going to ask, because a few questions, well, have been asked the senior, and if I allow too much more, then it'll be a second lecture. So let me ask you a quick response, and so we all hold just for a few minutes, and then respond to that full set, and then I think there was one or two to myself, so you can respond as well. And Dr. Henry, what's your
question? Yes, the first question was in relation to page 10 of the
yeah.
I think was recounting the evidence of a witness. I believe it was the representative of the contractor saying that was his evidence that the workers were paid by SMS at the rate of pay fixed by the agreement. That may or may not be so, but it certainly was the case that the other benefits were not extended. Shortfall of some
okay.
Estimate accounting and as processing the administrative at this point in time. Whether the list of ADA workers is exhausted, I can't answer that question now. I have to review the judgment of the court to see exactly who it said that its ruling applied to. So we have to look at the order of the court itself to determine whether they restricted it to the list or recognized that the list was not exhausted. That is something you have to look at closely. In this particular case, the contest was whether these workers fell within the definition of labor or the contract workers under the Industrial Relations Act. And because the bargaining unit that the union represented was large, there was really no dispute that if they were employed under the only contracts, they would fall within the bargaining unit. There may be cases where somebody is employed under the only contract, but you will have to figure out exactly what bargaining unit they belong to. That is just a matter of evidence. What the Industrial Relations Act does is to make sure that anybody who falls within that category of contracted work makes clear that the employer that they're working for is the employer. And once that is made clear, it means that they have rights, it means that the union can represent them, it means that they belong to a bargaining unit, whichever one that is, and it means that the collective agreement applies to them, whichever is the relevant collective agreement. The court in this particular case was careful not to restrict the order. It said that the company had to apply the appropriate collective agreement, so that it left it to the parties to answer those very questions. What collective agreement applied to the extent that they may have been one bargaining unit and not another. So that is something that was important. Contract workers, regular contract workers have better protection. It depends. Again, regular contract workers, who I think that term is used to be persons who are employed on a fixed contract. Their terms will be governed by the fixed contract, and if they are in a bargaining unit in any event, their terms and conditions will be governed by the collective agreement. The difference is that they will be employed only for that fixed term. So when the contract comes to an end, presumably, will come to an end, but all it depends on what the collective agreement says, because if the collective agreement does not allow for work to be appointed on fixed term contracts, then as you know, the collective agreement takes precedence over any individual contract that the employer enters into. So the answer is that they will have the same protection, but for the outstanding question as to whether the employment is for fixed term or not. The question of whether the judgment affects short-term workers, contract workers who might have different benefits. All this judgment deals with is whether these type of workers fall within the definition of contract workers. That's all it deals with. It has no impact whatsoever on any other type of contract work or short-term contract work. Those are will be governed by entirely different principles. This was just dealing with this particular type of worker who the employer may tell us, say, I was not my employee at all, so I have nothing to do with them. If you want protection, go somewhere else, not by me. That is what this judgment resolves.
Let's go from the individual employment rights. That suit has a basic form of rights against everybody's rights. It has not proven to be, you know, uncomfortable or anti-union in South Africa where it exists as basic condition. It does, for example, I put this on there. If you are employed by an employer in an agreement, you're not in a union, for instance, could you demand something as a legal right? Could you demand holidays as a legal right? Those are the issues. And you find that, okay, it's taken for granted that I'm entitled to holidays, I'm entitled to sick leave, and we mirror what the unions have won in terms of the those that they have won for security and holidays. But you do not have the legal right because you have not been trying the door. Barbados just next door has a holidays with pay act, which means that every individual is entitled to holidays with pay once. So the individual rights to speak about is not intended to diminish the rule of the union, but really to establish a minimum form of rights akin to, let's say, the minimum wage. So minimum form of rights. But nobody could take down a collective agreement state and say bring it down to the minimum. No. It's the minimum form across the board in the society. Once you're in employment in society, these are the minimum terms. I'm entitled to a pay slip. I'm entitled to sick leave. I'm entitled to maternity protection. Not only maternity protection, because in the cases of registration that we put up, you are entitled to parental leave, and you're also entitled as a basic right for maternity leave. So those are the things that we have been speaking about.
All right, thank you. What are we
going to
do now?
Oh, sorry. All right, very quickly, Chair. My friend from the minimum, Mr. Marcel from the UAE point about minimum rights, minimum wage, minimum floor. I think we at least have at least a minimum wage. The idea of a minimum floor of rights is something that and then there's the issue of the role of an organization like the National Union of Domestic
the right of a worker vis-a-vis an employer, irrespective of whether that employer has control over capital in that larger sense. The question is that if you can write a labor contract, if you can write a contract of labor, it means that you have certain rights, or you can presume to have certain rights to work a worker. We want to make sure that we have some level of balance in whatever the arrangement is. On the issue of ISCOT was indeed a state corporation in its incarnation, and we have to recognize that down the road we may have to go back right there.
Yeah. All right. What do you want to?
Acelor Mittal, coming from 1989, attending this part, then Cargan this part in 1995, then Mittal in 2000s. You know, Acelor Mittal. And I just glad to be here today. At least I've seen my union at work. Some of us say that the union doesn't work, but today at least we've seen proof that the union do work. The three questions I have to the table. I think this case started in about 1996. I think we petitioned the court somewhere around that time. And we then went to court in 1998, right? Today, now it's 2015. What are you looking at that? One, what time frame are we paying from? I'm guessing 89 years. There's anybody that's here too since 1989. Some of us was employed, some of us was not employed. And some of us designed as contract sorts. So what time frame are we looking at? The payment would be for this from 1989, from when we went to court, 1998, the first Sunday, and one, and actually, what benefits will we be receiving? Will it be sick leave? Will it be severance? Will it be holidays? Whatever, casual? And taking a look at the list, I see if I have 11 names on the list, which is actually from my department, in the med shop, in the gas department. And 11 names have no years of service time. I think that we are some of the longest serving guys within that whole system. So that's what I do. Return to one time.
All right.
Anybody else?
Thank you.
Good afternoon to the panel and everyone gathered here today. My name is Renata Ivel and I work at Cipriani College of Labor and Co-operative Studies. I'm part of the non-academic staff and we're represented by Bill. It's interesting to hear the comments from Mr. Leonard Marcel today, as this is the first time I have actually seen him on the compound. It's been past a year that he has been the chairman and he has never met with the staff. We have many industrial relations issues and occupational health issues in the industry that are exciting.
Approach also takes the pace of system like HR and global scale. And as the gentleman quite pointed out in his speech, and as the street gives us trade union as a collective body, what I want to know as a collective body, is there a mechanism of resolution being sought to bring remedy to these facts?
Thank you.
Distinguished panel, my name is David Reeves, Assistant General Secretary of the Estate Police Association.
Sorry, can you again repeat your name and ring?
David Reeves, Assistant General Secretary of the Estate Police Association. We have a situation where the Estate Police Association is only allowed to represent precepted people. The vast majority of the industry who are unprecepted, we can't do anything for them. All right, an out of court judgment back in 2009. My question to the panel Mr. Mendes, is with this new judgment, is there any way that the association can render some assistance to people who are unprecepted and are working in the industry? Right? With regard to wages, we can help with that. But other fundamental factors like hours of work, holidays, sick leave, we can't do anything for them. With this new judgment, can we use this judgment for the betterment of those people? Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, I think he's raising the issue, especially of security officers in Trinidad and Tobago. We have to see that's one of the most exploited group of workers we have. And I just want to say, as joint trade union, when we have to stand in solidarity with those security officers who go 12 hours. Yes, the final, you have the final word, not of the evening, the final word from the open session.
Well, I feel like my name is Garth Christopher. I'm here in my own private capacity this afternoon. I would like to take the learnings of this case and apply it to a company where there's a fair wage clause in the collective agreement. There's an agreement. There's a clause that will simply say all contract employees will receive a certain percentage of whatever the owner of a substantial post will get. So 80% or 90%. But that will exclude all those other benefits. How would this case impact a company like that? Because we have a few companies like that.
I want to respond to that last group of questions. In the meantime, can we get my mic back up here, please? For the closes.
Judgment was very specific to the type of movie.
not an answer for every problem that everybody may have. So that the specific problem of unreceptive workers are not dealt with by the judgment. And therefore the judgment doesn't provide an answer to those problems. And to the extent that you might have a fair wage clause in your collective agreement in relation to contract workers, well, that clause will have to be applied. Imagine that if a fair wage clause is simply saying that the collective agreement must be applied to those workers that are being contracted in, then it has the same effect as a finding that those workers are the only contract worker, because the effect of this judgment is that the collective agreement applies to you in any way. To the next extent, the fair wage clause is just a recognition of what the industrial relations act says. Just saying that the employer must apply. As far as the question that was asked by the lady with the microphone yesterday, I'm not too sure if I'm answering your question, but if not, maybe we can have a talk about it afterwards. The Industrial Relations Act is an attempt to regulate power relations between employers. That is what it does. And it does so by trying to contain the power of trade unions to the extent that it limits the trade union's ability to take strike action. So that's essentially what is happening in the Industrial Relations Act. As a matter of fact, all labor laws from the inception, whether it is laws passed by legislatures over time, or laws made by judges of common law, have always been laws attempting to regulate the relationship between employers and employees, or employers and trade unions, because at one point in time, the common law, that is judgment law, had outlawed trade unions. And it is only the intervention of the legislature over time, after struggles by the trade union movement, in Trinidad and Tobago as well, that resulted in legislation being passed to legalize trade unions. Criminal at some point in time, even to belong to a trade union. So that this is what labor laws seek to do. Where the balance is struck, of course, depends upon the historical moment that you're in. The historical moment that we are in now is that we have the Industrial Relations Act, and maybe this is another historical moment that should do some amendments that we've been talking about all the time, the longest while.
From 1994 to 1994.
Exactly. So maybe there's a moment to do some tweaking to the Industrial Relations Act to deal with the realign the relationship with the defendant. But generally speaking, the judgment is the judgment of the court is very specific. I say that there's a time and place for everything. There's a time and place as well for making comments. And therefore, there's a time and place for discussing preceptive workers as fair wage contracts and all that type of thing. But this judgment is very specific. It's very narrow. So it doesn't answer all the questions of service.
Making some faster, oral questions, some more profound statements, and I would like to really recognize that. But come on, yes,
so one more statement.
Thank you.
not yet met the chairman. We are happy to make arrangements to have that done. Please come talk to my office about that.
Chairman of the Cipriani College of Labor and Co-operative Studies, Mr. Lennox Marcel, Dr. Ralph Henry, another friend and comrade of the labor movement, senior friend and comrade of the Oilfield Workers Trade Union, comrades of my comrade at the head table here. My comrade at the president of the Steel Workers Union, and you know, I want to first to recognize in an overwhelming way the pivotal role that was played by the Steel Workers Union. Perhaps was not recognized before, but certainly deserved recognition now for that. President of the Steel Workers Union of Trinidad and Tobago. Our comrades here, fellow comrades of the Joint Trade Union Movement, comrades of the Blue Shield, and comrades all, good evening. Well, first as a practicing able-bodied trade unionist, I want to first of all say that I offer protection and would insist that the Cipriani College worker who spoke here this afternoon is not victimized. And notwithstanding all that was said, I'm going to not shift the focus, but to say that I'm not surprised by the comment from the worker about the performance of the chairman of the college, given our earlier interaction and so on, and earlier disappointments that we have expressed right here in the labor movement. I want to also say that there was a great opportunity not too long ago to put on the stage, to put in focus and to deal with all of these issues, whether it be a flow of rights, or whether it be dealing with a lot of the disadvantaged contract worker or whatever form, There was great opportunity, but I don't know that persons who had that opportunity seized the moment to deal effectively with that. And that is as much I want to say about that this evening. But this evening, I have lots more to say, but that is as much I want to say about that. Being in the corridors and at the air of certain people, it certainly did not bear fruit. But let me also say that the contract worker, like the security worker, are two of the most exploited workers you'll find, not just in Trinidad and Tobago, but throughout the world. It is the dime a dozen syndrome that you can find a contract worker anywhere, pay him or her anything, and get out of him or her maximum. And that drives the intention of employers everywhere, that you can exploit provisions in the collective agreement, even in the collective agreement, registered in the Ministry of Labour and at the courts. You can flaunt those provisions, exploit it, and at the end of the day, you are allowed to get away simply because you have deep pockets. And I also want to say that that is a position that an example of, examples of which was also set by the state. And if you believe that it is employers, private employers alone that would have done that, the state, the government of Trinidad and Tobago, historically, but more so over the last 5 years, would have exploited to the hilt a lot of contract workers under whatever form of engagement. And so, we in the joint trade union movement this evening thought it necessary to bring to sharp focus the issue of the plight of the contract workers, and to do so by highlighting this particular judgment, this landmark judgment that we believe would be held up to deal with contract workers, not just at the various workplaces where you have collective agreement, but raising the awareness of the plight of the contract workers and having standards brought to bear on behalf of those workers everywhere. And so it is an initiative of the International Labour Federation, to which both the Steel Workers Union and the Oilfields Workers Trade Union are affiliated. We are affiliated to the Confederation of Trade Unions called the Industrial represents some 1,000 trade unions in over 108 countries across the globe, representing a total of some 50 million workers. And it has designated today as a day against precarious work. And precarious work is really contract work. And that all of these issues that we discuss here, most of them are issues that will discuss, still being discussed, and we are trying to find a way, not just in Trinidad and Tobago, a global response to that type of global exploitation of labor. And so we join hands with workers across the world today, trade unions across the world today, under the Confederation of Trade Unions in Industrial, in recognizing this day against precarious work, and today by our own effort here, by highlighting these concerns and educating in ways that we thought we did here this evening, the plight of the contract workers. I want to also say that sometimes we too are guilty as workers in various workspaces, because we have a type of class division with the permanent worker and the contract worker. And that once we have that type of division and see ourselves as elitists, having superior terms and conditions and benefits over the contract worker, and didn't care about the plight of the contract worker, or feel that the task that the contract worker is called to perform, that he could not do, I'm permanent. It is a kind of syndrome that leads to down the bad road that the employers at the end of the day exploit. Too many occasions we have seen work that was refused to be done on the basis of those work being unsafe by the permanent worker, but that the contract worker, right in the presence of the permanent worker, is allowed to do it, and the permanent worker does not stand up for the contract worker. Our position is and must always be clear that a worker is a worker anywhere, and that a worker is entitled to rights, whether he be permanent, casual, temporary, or contract worker, and that we must do so with the type of solidarity that is necessary to protect such a worker. We continuously make the point to those of us who enjoy provisions detailed in the collective agreements, fought for and struggled and won in the collective agreements, that when you protect the right of the contract worker, which contract worker is covered in your collective agreement, what in fact you are doing, you are insulating and you are protecting your collective agreement. You are protecting your own job security in that regard. And in that regard, I want to again hail our comrades from the Steelworkers Union and hold supreme, making it uncost effective for the employers who previously felt that it is cost effective to make the job classification in the schedule of classification in the various collective agreements, make that cheap by paying one third, one quarter, and some, in some cases one eighth of what is the rate, the going rate in the collective agreement. We now have a situation where it will be, it has to be made very expensive for the employers to engage contract work where permanent work is supposed to be engaged. And therefore, we come back to the point that if a job within my schedule of classification in my collective agreement is a job that ought to be done by a permanent worker, the worker who performed that must not just be given comparable or identical benefits, but such a worker must be deemed to be a permanent worker. And that. In fact, wildfire from government ministries in different configurations, and you know it. But at the end of the day, the contract worker does not enjoy or cannot enjoy the level of job security that the permanent worker enjoys. And I heard Dr. Henry, I took a bit of a note of what happens with governments, and in particular, our government here in the past and perhaps in the present and going forward, that because of their wanting to attract foreign investors to our shores, you might very well find them turning their backs on the level of exploitation down to the contract workers in circumstances where that is necessary. But I also want to immediately match that by saying that the preamble of our constitution states that labor must not be exploited or be made to work in inhuman conditions for economic gains. And therefore we hold that up as supreme, that is to say that if we are to benefit economically, we are not prepared to sell ourselves short as workers, but as contract workers. I think it is a respect for human beings, first of all, that every worker is a human being and ought to be treated with a high level of decency, dignity, and respect, and therefore from that would flow what type of treatment is meted out to contract workers. Our collective agreement today is under serious and severe attack by various employers, and I'm not now going to single out some of the employers here this afternoon, although I see some representatives of the employers whom I know to be guilty of exploiting contract workers and a particular provision in the collective agreement. May I say that the collective agreement, the provision in the collective agreement, let me say that for some clarity. We recognize that all work performed by the various entities, various companies, would not be work required on a permanent basis. And that we recognize that some work will be of a project nature, some work will be of a turnaround nature, and therefore, in those circumstances, you would require a higher level of workforce, greater numbers of workers, which would fit into various parts or particular classification within your collective agreement. But as you do that, as the company or the entity engage those workers, the particular collective agreement provision speaks to the way in which that ought to be regulated. And in my own experience, in the collective agreements that we deal with, that is the exact name of that particular clause. It is called the regulation of contract work. It is precisely because we recognize the need to have contract work, but to have it regulated in a particular way. And so it is within that clause you would find the definition of the level of benefits that the contract worker ought to receive while he or she is at work within the particular classification and so on. But all of those things, even the judgment that we know here this afternoon, would be lost upon us if we did not continue to be super vigilant going forward now to ensure that tell every employer that we now have a judgment, which if you go to the very limit, we already have a judgment to deal with that. So even your deep pockets would not suffice. As a matter of fact, I can say here that very judgment, Commerce and their Council, in respect of the security workers who are non-preceptive, but who fall within provisions of a particular bargaining unit in one company, we would have held that judgment up. And on the basis of that, we are going to declare very soon a number of those contract workers who are exploited as security workers, we expect them, those terrible security, we expect them to receive rates comparable to those in the schedule of time. So already it is working for us, and we have to continue. And I want to end here by thanking all of us for coming out and fielding questions. And in cases where we didn't ask questions, the response would have informed us a little more. We have to continue the education process. We have to continue the process of institutional building and so on. And in that regard, let me just take a plug here to say, without the $15 million, we have to do it. With a level of interest and a level of commitment to, as union officers, remain true to the duty and task of ensuring that workers are not exploited and that every worker gets what he or she deserves according to the particular collective agreement. Yeah? Again, let me thank you for a well-spent evening. My late arrival here, for which I want to apologize at this moment, had to do with just that we were discussing with the power generation company. Is there any power gen company here? We were discussing in a meeting with the power generation company of Trinidad and Tobago, their intention to, and many announced here this evening, their intention to retire the power station in Port of Spain. And as they retire that power station, of course it would have job loss and so on. But as they do that, and as they are now ill prepared to do that, they are rushing the workers to take voluntary separation packages. And while they do that, because they are ill prepared and still have to have the facilities running, they are prepared to do what? Use contract workers in the cases where permanent workers ought to be at home. We have to ensure, as I close, that our worker is our worker, wherever that worker exists, and that we stand up in solidarity with all workers as we claim that the price of freedom is eternal vigilance. Thank you very much, Thomas.
Wait, hold on, I'm not finished yet. 5 more minutes, just 5 more minutes. 3 more minutes, actually. Just for reminding us that the price of freedom is eternal vigilance. Let's give Comrade Anson Roger another round of applause. I would just like to ask Comrade Wayne Roberts, where is he? Is he here? Come and stand right in the center and I explain to the audience why I've signaled you out. Yeah, come. Don't worry, I'll explain. I got muscle fibers. Sometimes, as of any movement, we always have to really pay recognition, because sometimes you kind of let things slide by. But you see this, comrade? This was the Chief Labor Relations Officer in 1998 who took the decision that we're going to fight Acelor Mittal. So, comrade, we want to recognize your foresight and for being and reminding us what true trade unionism is all about. No matter how big the enemy, we will fight for and on behalf of workers. I would now like to call on Mr. Lesmore Fredericks, who is the head of the, you know, we can give him a round of applause. Head of Labor Relations, to give the official vote of thanks. And let me just ask, as soon as he's finished, don't get up. There's just one last thing I'd like for you to do before we invite you for some visits. Small. Very small. So do not, as soon as you finish, get up. There's just one little task that I'd like everyone to participate in. Trade unionists and non-trade unionists here. So just bring up Mr. Fredericks.
So all for the call of observe. May I say, it has been a wonderful evening. And as such, I think we should applaud for but I think it's very important to recognize the intervention, very important in the context of labor education, trade union education. So credit must be given, serious recognition, to the joint trade union movement, and the summit movement, and credit to the Labor College, Cipriani Labor College. The union, and that is beautiful. I wanted to thank you to all of the people. I do not want to leave anyone out, so I said all those who were involved in making this exercise, this union, a wonderful evening. And I said thank you very much. And something has happened this evening, which few occasions I have seen it in a positive way. I want to say thank you, students, or visitors, to remain to this end. It is not the law. And that is not the law. That's it. That's it. Thank you all very much.
Thank you very much. Now, I mentioned something earlier and I feel very strongly about it. That is, in order for us to fight global capital, solidarity, regional, national, together, therefore, there is no way we can leave here. Come on, do I really have to say? I'd like for us to all stand and say.
Baby, someone let me. Can't you lie? Mother, you need. Aren't you baby? Someone.